Good morning. Welcome to St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church in Maple, Ontario. I'm Alan Kay, your welcoming elder. I have with me Dr. Jackie Perriott working on the soundboard. And we're going to open today's service with our Lenten reading. And we have Fabrizio Piazza leading us in that. So go ahead, Fab.
Good morning.
Morning.
During Lent, God hears the desires of our hearts and chooses what is best for us. God draws us into a deeper relationship, offering us compassion, mercy, and insight.
God hears and responds to our plans when they honor God's purposes for creation.
While we don't always recognize it, sometimes our dreams can be distorted, harmful, and not consistent with God's principles.
We praise God for when God says yes, and for when God says no.
Let us pray.
All-knowing God, you see and understand all things. You walk with us on the journey to Christian maturity, and we know that you provide us guidance and wisdom. Help us to follow your ways. Make us patient when you correct us. Forgive us when we resist your newness, and encourage us when we seek new ways of being.
Let our lives
conform to the pattern of the life of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Fabrizio. And now, let me introduce Reverend Fred Tham to lead us in today's worship. Go ahead, Fred.
Good morning. Let us enter into our time of a responsive call to worship. Seek the Lord while God may be found. Call upon God who is near.
We will return to the Lord our God.
God's thoughts are not our thoughts. God's ways are not our ways.
We come seeking new paths to follow.
As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are God's ways higher than ours.
We come as pilgrims on the journey, praising God along the way.
Let us worship God with thankful hearts.
And our opening hymn today is Amazing Grace. We got to hear this last week, and so we're a great choice for again Amen. Today.
Amazing.
I invite everybody to stand and sing.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. And I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are mercy rains, an ending.
Amen.
Thank you. Please be seated.
Let us pray together. God, our creator and sustainer, in you we live and move and have our being. In your depths we find meaning. In your heights we find light and joy. You are the source of peace and hope for all who turn to you. You alone have been our help and our guide. You give us strength and courage when we face challenges. In you we find rest and welcome along the way. We praise you, O God, for your steadfast love. Draw near to us once more in this time of worship. Reveal your purposes for us and prepare us for the days ahead so that our lives may witness to your mercy and grace as we follow Jesus. God of grace and mercy, we confess that our thoughts are so often not your thoughts. Our ways are rarely your ways. Our tempers are short and we fail to act with kindness. Our confidence is weak and we treat others without respect. Our faith falters and we lose track of you. Forgive the many ways we fail you and inspire us to follow you more faithfully. Family of God, brothers and sisters, let us now receive assurance of pardon. Hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn us? Only Christ, and Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. In Christ, we are forgiven. By Christ's mercy, we can make a fresh start following him. The result of the Reformation was the wonderful doctrine of the priesthood of all believers. And as priests, we can share the peace of Christ with one another. I'd like to invite you to do so now, to turn to your neighbor and share the peace of Christ. You can use the symbol of the peace that has often been used, or as however you like to share it. Peace of Christ to you.
And also,
and
with,
also
you.
With you.
I'd like to say once again, good morning. And thank you for welcoming me here to this pulpit. It is an honor. And one of the joys that I have in coming here is particularly the time we have to share with young people and with youth. The Bible is full of wonderful, gracious illustrations. Isaiah 55 begins with a call to the thirsty to come to the waters. That is the passage that will be read to us in a few minutes. It talks about water quenching our thirst, not just physical thirst, but it talks about a spiritual thirst. And in Scripture, we are told that God quenches our spiritual thirst, and there is no end to his grace and mercy for us. That is why I'd like to show you a little illustration, pretending this to be the thirst quencher from Scripture. God fulfills our thirst. And Jesus said this: blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 6. Thank you, doctor. Those who seek to remain righteous through the Lord Jesus Christ are granted the thirst-quenching experience of eternal life in him. Jesus said to the woman at the well, "Whoever drinks of this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But that water that I shall give him will become to him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life." John chapter 4, verses 13 to 14. If faith awakens a sense of need in our souls, it is to Jesus that we must go to satisfy that need. Then we will receive the Holy Spirit and not only quench our own thirst and find rest in him, but we will become channels of his blessing to others who need it, other needy souls. As the water, the context of the passage in John 7 was the Feast of the Tabernacles. And at one point, the water was symbolically poured out, and Jesus stood at the temple and called out, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and to drink." So what do we need to purchase this water that satisfies your thirst to no end? We can't purchase it ourselves, not out of our good works. It is the free gift of the true and living God who supplies all of our needs. All the spiritual refreshment we need, symbolized by water and wine and milk, is ours without money and without price. We just need to ask God for the forgiveness of our sins to the Lord Jesus Christ. It costs us nothing because Jesus paid the full price for our penalty, for our sins, when he gave his life in our place on the cross of Calvary. There he knew the pain and suffering that we should have known. And he even cried out in his own anger and anguish. He said, "I thirst." If we seek the Lord, he will certainly satisfy us. He is not far from any one of us. When should we seek him? Do so today. While he may be found, we should seek the Creator in the days of our youth, we're told in the Old Testament. Before we become so set in our ways that we become difficult, that it is difficult for us to hear him, we should seek him in the ripeness of our old years as well, when there is still breath in our mouths, to call out for his mercy upon our souls. We should call upon him while he is near, while the call of the gospel is still ringing in our ears. Now is a set time for the Lord to favor his people. So do not leave this until tomorrow, what you must do today. The Apostle Paul says, "Now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation." As we hear his voice today, we must not harden our hearts to provoke him, but respond positively to the call of the gospel. For Jesus says, "Come unto me, all who are labored and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Receive the soul-quenching goodness of the Holy Spirit today. I can write... Prayer of Illumination.
Thank you, Fabio. Wow, that was quite amazing, everybody. I hope you saw that. So that was quite wonderful. So let's pass it over to Fabrizio Piazza again, who is going to read scripture for us today.
Thank you, Alan. Fred, we'd like to know how you did that. Let us pray. Loving God, attend to us as we open your word. May our hearts and spirits listen for your will for us today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. First reading from scripture is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 55, verses 1 to 9, New International Version. Invitation to the thirsty. "Come, all who are thirsty, come to the waters, and you have no money, And you who have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread, and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen to me and eat what is good, and you will delight in the richest of fare. Give ear and come to me, listen, that you may live. I will make everlasting covenant with you, my faithful love promised to David. See, I have made him a witness to the peoples, a ruler and commander of the peoples. Surely he will summon nations you know not, and nations you do not know will come running to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has endowed you with splendor. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteousness their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on them, to our Lord, and he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. The second book is from New Testament, Luke, Gospel of Luke, chapter 13, verses 1 to 9. Repent or perish. Now there were some present at the time who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mixed with their sacrifices. Jesus answered, "Do you think that the Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered this way? I tell you no, but unless you repent, you too will all perish. Or those 18 who died when the tower in Siloam fell on them. Do you think they were more guilty than all the others living in Jerusalem? I tell you no, but unless you repent, you too will all perish." Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree growing in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit on it, but did not find any. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, "For 3 years now, I've been coming to look for fruit on this fig tree and haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it use up the soil?" "Sir," the man replied, "leave it alone for one more year, and I'll dig around it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit next year, fine. If not, then cut it down." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our choral anthem for today is "Jesus, Thou of Loving Hearts." So let's all stand and sing together.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, we turn to the scripture to seek your wisdom and your truth. Send your Holy Spirit to open our minds and hearts to receive your word for our lives and our times. Equip us to follow Jesus Christ, your living word. Amen. In the passage, the second passage that was read to us this morning, there is a theme. Did you catch that theme? It was repeated several times, and the theme is repentance. That is a theme that is throughout Scripture, but particularly repeated in the life of Christ and the beginning of the ministry of John the Baptist. In Mark chapter 1, verse 14, we have a reference to this as the same theme. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of the gospel of God. And he said this, "The time has come. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news." At that critical boiling point of Jesus' public ministry, the key word was repent. It is repeated again and again in the Gospels, and it means change. It means to acknowledge what we have done or where we have been, where we are, and where we are going, that all these things need to change. If you are a business person, you may have heard a phrase. It was more popular perhaps a few years ago, but is this phrase. It is called the critical transaction. If you listen to people who analyze business organizations, you may have heard that term, and it refers simply to that single event that all businesses need to have happen that legitimizes or justifies everything else that they do. For example, in the airline industry, the critical transaction is not that the plane takes off from the runway. It is not when the mechanic fixes the plane. No, the critical transaction for the airline industry is when someone buys a plane ticket. It sounds simple, but if people do not buy plane tickets, nothing else can happen. The critical transaction happens at that counter or online, perhaps. Interestingly enough, by the way, just as an aside, businesses often pay the people responsible for the critical transaction the lowest salaries, and they give them the poorest training. How about the church? What is our critical transaction? I believe that Jesus points that out in the passage and underlines the passage that was read to us. It's an important theme for us as we go through the season of Lent, because we are forced to think about this topic. Jesus calls people to repent. John the Baptist preached a gospel of repentance. The critical transaction in a church comes at the moment someone says, "I want to," or "I need to change." Unless someone says, "I repent," or "I want to change," there's really nothing of value a church can do for someone. We can entertain, we can keep people busy, we can help them out in difficult times, or feed them, or inform them, or provide them friendship. But that's not the primary purpose of the church. A church is meant to be a place where the power of Almighty God can be felt through the strength of preaching of the gospel, but it can only make sense in the heart and the mind through the ears of the person who says, "I need to change and to grow." The church cannot do anything for unrepentant people. People must see their need before they buy any product. That is one of the basic values of marketing today, isn't it? And similarly, we must see our need to change before we can be transformed by God. All of us need to change in some way or other. I know that for myself, maybe I blame COVID, but it's really more than that. I need to lose weight. And my wife is always reminding me that I need to see the need to change to lose the weight before I actually do it. The same is true of teenagers who need to learn to take responsibility. Bad drivers, you need to learn to heed the law. Churches are struggling today, many of them, because people don't need see their need to change. They think that it's shortcuts is all they need. They need to realize that the gospel is there because we need to change. A lot of people don't want to change. They have defense mechanisms. Let me list to you a few of these defense mechanisms against change. I use them myself in other areas of my life. How about denial? You say, I don't need to change. Everything is fine. How about blame? There are some changes that are necessary, but they're everybody else's fault or the system's fault only. There's defensiveness. You know, that's just your opinion. There's vindictiveness. Changes are necessary, but it's all your fault, and I'm going to sue you if you don't change. That's such a common thing. So many people have built walls around themselves and refuse to ask themselves the difficult question, where do I need to change to grow in character and to develop as a person? E. Stanley Jones was a great missionary to India, and he went around the country holding retreats for spiritual renewal. And he would gather people together and say, I have three questions for you at the beginning of those retreats. I want you to wrestle with these questions. The first question is, why are you here? The second question is, what do you need? And the third question is, what do you want God to say to you? We need to stop and reflect before our worship services, before our classes or group meetings, and say to ourselves, why are we here? What do we need? And what is God saying to us today that we need to change? As Jesus spoke in the synagogues and countryside, that is what he was constantly saying. People, I am offering you an opportunity to change, but my opportunity and my message will make no sense to you unless you come to me softened, open your hearts ready to receive that which will meet your deepest need. Dear people, brothers and sisters, family of God, when it comes to the gospel, nothing of any valuable way happens unless we see our need to repent. And in scripture, repentance is very specific. It is not just feeling sorrowful, although that is a part of it. There is often, and there should be, emotion attached to it. But it is the determination to change. The word itself means to stop going in one direction, but to go in the other direction. That is why we are told in scripture, God at times says he repents of something. It doesn't mean that he has sinned, because God cannot sin. But that's the old English way of saying he is going in one direction and he's made a decision to change and go in another direction in regard to a certain issue. We are told in scripture that the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord that he may have compassion on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. We are told in scripture, when we repent, God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins. In Psalm 32, verse 5, we're told, then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. The apostles, John the Baptist, Jesus, and the apostles made repentance at the core of their message. In Acts chapter 3, verse 18 to 19, we're told, but this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Messiah should suffer. Verse 19, repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out and the times of refreshing may come from the Lord. And then later, the apostle says, the times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. And God is faithful and just, and he will forgive us our sins, and he will make all things new. Let us now respond by singing On Eagle's Wings.
Got the wrong camera on. Hold on, here we go. Hello, everyone. So offerings can be provided to St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church by going online and with our partnership with CanadaHelps.org. Go to www.CanadaHelps.org/en/dn/56495, or donations can be mailed or delivered to St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church, 9860 Keele Street, Vaughan, Ontario, L6A 3Y4. For those who are here in the sanctuary, then donations can be left in the baskets at the Keele Street exit. Today's mission moment is discussing about Presbyterian sharing. Through the gifts of Presbyterian sharing, the Presbyterian Church in Canada is able to support many important outreach ministries associated with Cyclical PCC, a church planting support initiative. One such ministry is Cornerstone Ministries. Cornerstone Ministries provides Christian hope and healing through innovative and supportive practices to struggling single moms and families in the Dunnville area of Ontario. Since moving most of their ministry work online, many more people have been positively impacted by Cornerstone. Through outreach, counseling, and practical support, over 200 local families have come to know the God who loves them, helping them to blossom in faith, courage, and wholeness. And before I get back to Reverend Tham, I have one announcement, which is that, again, our annual general meeting will be held next Sunday, so March the 22nd, 2022, at noon, so right after service, our regular service time, as soon as our interim moderator can get here from Thornhill. All members and adherents are requested to attend. And one of the important things is that, as you are maybe aware, our the nominations for eldership did close last week, and we do have candidates. One with which will not require a vote is for Blossom Lobo. She's going to be returning from medical leave and returning to regular duties as an elder. Also, Jerise Kakesh has asked to be reelected to be an elder. He has been an elder in the past. And newly, Naomi Hussein is standing for election. So we will be looking for the affirmatives on those candidates. And I look forward to all of you attending at next week's annual general meeting so that we can confirm and elect them. And I trust that you will all think positively about that and pray upon that before next week. There will also be other discussions regarding the finances of the church and other matters in terms of the direction that we are going. I'd also like to let everybody know that we are going to continue with masking. So I can have my mask. I'm just not going to do it while I'm speaking on the microphone. We are going to continue masking for at least for the near future. So that will include next week. But on Easter Sunday, we are going to have our first in-person fellowship since the pandemic began. So I do invite all of you after church on Easter Sunday to come into the fellowship hall and have some time together. So very happy to and pleased to be able to bring that to everybody. And we'll have some hot cross buns, Jackie. Yes, that's correct. So thank you all. And now let me turn it back to Reverend Tham.
So glad to hear that as the world opens up again, that this congregation is also, and very good to hear that. Let us now enter into a more extended time of prayer. We'll have a prayer for dedication, during which I will pause at times to allow you to think through how the Lord is calling you to pray about your own personal issues. That is during a time of thanksgiving and intercession, actually right after the prayer of dedication. So let us enter now into a time of prayer. Loving God, accept these our gifts, we pray. Bless them and use them to inspire peace in places of unrest, love in places of resentment, joy in places of fear, and hope in places of loss, all for the sake of Jesus Christ, our friend and Savior. God of hope, when the world is confusing and frustrating, you bring light and hope. We thank you for lessons learned, for changes of heart, for fresh discoveries made and new paths followed. Even during these months of pandemic, we pray this day for those who are confused or afraid, for those who feel anger or despair. And we pray in particular for the church in the Ukraine, in a land who has entered into war, in a place and a time that will be a pivot of a time that will be remembered for generations to come, a time in which there is great suffering. We keep them in our prayers. O God, give us hope in this time. Turn our hearts to you. God of peace, there is so much conflict, hostility, and antagonism around us and within us. Personal relationships are often tense. The world, community at odds. We pray for understanding to prevail in relationships, at home, at work, in our community, in our country, in our world. We pray for diplomacy to end conflict and threat among nations. O God, give us peace in these times. Turn our hearts to you. God of joy, we give you thanks for moments of joy and celebration in our lives, for small pleasures given and received through times of isolation. We remember those who feel left out or bitter, those who are anxious or in distress. We pray for those who face loss and hardship in these uncertain times, and for all who know sorrow and suffering. O God, give us joy in our time. Turn our hearts to you. God of community and compassion, we thank you for your steadfast presence in the face of all that brings uncertainty and worry these days. Bless our congregation and every church that is struggling. Inspire us to consider renewed ministry and mission after months of restricted gatherings. Give us wisdom as we approach the annual meeting next week. Reawaken our love for one another and our desire to worship and serve together in Jesus' name. Sustain leaders who feel exhausted by the challenges that they've faced, and renew our stewardship with gratitude for your love. O God, give us strength in our service. Turn our hearts to you. God of grace, receive these prayers and the unspoken prayers of our hearts. Deepen our trust in you for the days ahead. We offer ourselves as Jesus' friends and followers in the words that he taught us. Let us now repeat the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those that sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
And our concluding hymn is I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say. And this is the soloist is Wendy Ritchie. And it comes from Celtic Source, Volume 2, Worship on Ancient Soil. So again, let us all stand and come together in song as we sing our concluding hymn. And then you might as well stay standing at the end for the benediction. Thank you.
Please remain standing to receive the benediction from the word of the Lord. To him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ, our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. May you be seated.
Well, everyone, on behalf of the session here at St. Andrew's, we do appreciate and thank you for all the support that you provide to us. And And we'd like thank you for coming out, those who are able to join us here in the sanctuary, as things start continue to open up here in Ontario. And again, for those who are watching us through the live stream and those who watch us through the video replay, God bless all of you. And now, everyone, let us go now in peace as we sing our sending song.
If you're unable to stand, it's okay to stand as able, okay?